Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you this morning. Thank you for being here, and thank you to all those who are joining via live stream. It's great to be with you today. My name is David Webb, and today I have the special privilege of being with my beautiful, witty,
that's enough,
smart, but most importantly, virtuous wife, Tara Webb. Can we give her a hand real quick?
Thank you. Go ahead. Amen. Keep on.
It's been a while since we've done this.
It has.
It's been a while since we've actually been behind the pulpit, been behind a table, and shared together. Has it not?
Been years. Yep.
Well, we're looking forward to it, and we want to thank you for being a part of it. Many of you know that we're in the middle of a series that we've entitled Homeland, and the subtitle that we've given this series is A Covenant Stronger Than Storms. And that's the thing that we want to emphasize over and over each and every week, that we have a covenant that originates with God that is stronger than any storm that you may encounter. In week one, we talked about entanglements and the importance of getting rid of those entanglements because of the things that it can cost you, of the way that it can bind you, of the things that it can strip you of. Last week, my amazing wife, she did a great job of sharing last week, and she shared on Gardening 101 about you define your garden. And the way that we do that is through our words and with our words. Well, this past week, as we get into what we have for this week, I ran across a statistic that says that 90% of Americans will get married at some point in their life. If you're single here, or if you're single watching my live stream, that should be very encouraging to you, that there is someone out there that God has for you. The odds are in your favor. But what's interesting about that statistic is this, is that 4 or 5 years ago, that number was 95% of Americans would get married. Why the drop-off? I can only believe that it's a result of the satanic assault and the war that he is waging against marriages. People seem these days to be more hesitant to say, I do, because of uncertainty, even fear, whether it's economically, whether it's politically, whether it's relationally, religiously, whatever that may be, they are more hesitant, uncertain, and even fearful to say, I do. But yet God created those words for a man and a wife, and we see it all the way back in the beginning of time when God formed male and female one for another. You know, the time that you want to learn about marriage really is not during marriage. The best time, I won't say the only time, but the best time to learn about marriage is before you get married. I don't know if you know this or not, but if the best time to prepare and a study for a test is not during the test. If you were to go to the hospital and have a procedure or to have an operation, I'm assured that your desire would be for that surgeon not to be practicing or studying surgery during your procedure, that you would hope that it would have transpired before that. Well, it's the same way in marriage. I know that there are different tenures and years of marriage that are represented here, marriages that have been longer than you and I have been married, 50 years, 40 years, 30 years. I know that there may be some people here who are newlywed, people here who are kicking the tires in dating or getting to know one another, newly engaged, whatever that may be. I'm telling you, the best time to learn about marriage is before, but you always want to continue learning. So whether you've been married for a long time today, whether you're watching by live stream and you're newly married, or you're here today and you're recently engaged or you're looking to get married, I'm telling you that even before you get married, the things that we can glean from the Word of God not only apply to marriage, but to other relationships and even your life. We just have to glean these things and make them applicable in our life.
You know, marriage is a fun journey, and has all kind of ups and downs. But I remember when you and I were engaged to be married, and one day I was at your house. For some reason, you weren't there. I was there with his mom, and we were walking down their hallway, and she took me back to their bedroom for some reason, and we walked in, and on her bed was this beautifully wrapped gift that had her name on it. And so she picked it up and opened it up, and sure enough, she pulled out this gorgeous dress that he had bought for her. It was not her birthday. It was not her anniversary. It was not Valentine's Day. It was no special occasion. It was just a gift of love. And I saw that, and it marked me. I had not been around that before. Their whole marriage, their whole life, their environment, the atmosphere of their home, I had not been around that kind of atmosphere before. And anyway, I could tell that she, you know, picked up on my shock by that gift, like it caught me off guard. And she looked at me and she said, "Tara, I'm going to tell you something. If you'll be faithful to build your marriage, one day you'll be getting these kinds of things too." Well, it excited me, you know. And so, of course, we were engaged, and I couldn't hardly wait to get married. And so, but I really had the thought that that's what I was going to step into. You know, you get married, and then the gifts start coming, and the parties happen, and the vacations, and all the fun and games, you know.
You're saying that didn't happen?
No, it didn't. And so, well, some, but a lot more now.
Okay.
Yeah. You've done really good, honey.
Thank you.
It took you a while. So anyway, so I stepped into that and really was excited about this new journey. And I realized that to get to where I did not know them in their younger years of marriage. I didn't see them come through everything that they had done and all the ingredients that it took to create that. It's a lot like baking a cake or baking cookies. I've baked a few cookies in my day. And I remember one time in particular, we were in the busy holiday season, and it was a day that it was a long day. When you got to bake and ship 5,000 cookies in a day, it's a long day. So we were nearing the end of that day, seeing light at the end of the tunnel, and all of a sudden I realized we're going to run out of ginger snaps. We're not going to have enough to fill this order. This is back when we were living in California. I told the girl working for me, I said, "Hey, you go mix up some ginger snap dough, and I'm going to stay here and finish this task, and then we'll get it finished." So she did. We got the cookies baked, but as they came out of the oven, there was something really off on these cookies. And I knew, I went through the recipe with her, and sure enough, she had left out the baking soda. Well, that's not going to make a cookie work, you know. And so, but, you know, marriage is a lot like that. What I was seeing was the sugar in the cookie. When I saw their marriage and their life that they had created and they had built, I saw the sweet stuff. I saw the parties, I saw the celebrations, I saw all that they had built. But it's not just about the sugar. It takes all the other ingredients. It takes the teaspoon of baking soda. It takes the teaspoon of vanilla. And left out, you can feel it and you can taste it, and it's a failure. So I'm here with my husband to talk about all the ingredients that are necessary to make a marriage great or to make a marriage great again. Hey, you like that? Make a marriage great again?
There you go. Make a marriage great again.
That's good.
You ought to trademark that.
I should.
Jump on that.
Just leave the space out between A and marriage. A marriage. Just one word.
So as she says, there are a lot of ingredients that go into making a marriage, and even more so, a godly and successful marriage. And that's what we want to share with you this morning. Some ingredients, some to-dos after you say, "I do." Because it seems like a lot of people, after they say, "I do," they don't know what to do. It's like, what do I do now after I've said I do? And so we want to share some of these things with you. So we're going to share a little bit of this, and we're actually going to carry this over into next week, which is our final week, and close this out. So the first thing that I want to share with you, one of the first ingredients, one of the first to-dos when it comes to after you've said "I do," is this. If your wife says, "You do whatever you want to do," then don't do anything. Stop. Do not pass go or collect $200. Don't breathe. Don't play video games. Don't go play golf. Protect every vital organ. Play dead, because if you really do whatever you want to do, it's not going to go well with you.
That's right.
No, I'm just kidding. That is code if your wife ever tells you that. You do whatever you want to do, you do what she tells you to do.
That's right.
That's what that's code for. You do what she tells you to do. No, I'm just kidding. That's not even point number one. Point number one is seriously this. Point number one is continually close the gap. You know, with dating, there is always a continual pursuit. There's a continual time of chasing, of calling and texting. I don't know about you, but I certainly know for me that texting was not a main form of communicating with people that I may have been dating, or certainly you and I. It wasn't the main form of communication. We called each other more than anything else. And I can remember in those times when I was pursuing and chasing, you know, the relationship that I wanted with you, I can remember as I called you, I did it so often and so frequently that I can remember my parents coming in and saying, David, get off the phone. David, it is time to come eat. It is time to go to church. It is time to go somewhere. Get off the phone. There were even times where they came to me and showed me the phone bill, saying, here's your portion of this bill due to the frequency of your calling. I don't know if you remember, but there weren't even unlimited plans in those days. When I got my own cell phone and took on that responsibility, you had to buy a plan that had minutes. And so it was amazing how high that bill would jump if you went over the minutes. But most of it was due to my pursuit and my chasing and desire to pursue a relationship with her. And that's the thing. With dating, with getting to know someone, with pursuing a relationship, there is a pursuit. Yet after many people say I do, it is amazing how often that pursuit comes to a halt. How that pursuit comes and slows down or comes to a stop. You have to continually fight to close the gap in that relationship. I believe the biggest reason for this is because of monotony. I believe familiarity sets in. I believe life gets busy, and as a result, the gap between a spouse can develop and it can widen. Have you ever heard someone say this? I feel like I've lost my love for my spouse. I know that I have. I've heard people say, I've lost my love for my spouse. It's, in most cases, it's not said from a place of meanness or spite. It's said from a place of devastation. It's like, how in the world did I get here? How in the world in this relationship did I come to lose my love for my spouse? I don't love them like I once did. Can I even overcome this? And that's what her and I are here to share with you this morning, that the answer is a resounding yes. You can overcome this. You can recover from this. But here's the difference. Nowhere in the Word of God does it tell you or teach you how what to do when you have lost your love for someone or for God. You won't find that anywhere in the Bible about if you've lost your love for someone or for God, what to do. What the Bible does tell you is found in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4. It says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works. There's a big difference. A lot of people say, well, I've lost my love. No. What's happened is you've left your love. You've left. There's a huge difference, because when you lose something, what that implies is that that is no longer recoverable in that relationship. And at its truest definition, that's what lose means. It ceases to be a part of your life. It means that you can no longer recover that or have that once again in your life. But here's the difference between lost and have left, or left. When you leave something, you have a recollection, you have a remembrance of where it is. It comes down to, are you going to go back and recover that thing in your life? There's the difference. It's a choice. At its truest definition, lost doesn't have a choice. It's gone. When you leave something, you have a choice whether you're going to go back and recover that and see that brought back into your life. And that's the choices that many marriages face today. When they say I've lost something, what they really mean is I've left something. I don't know whether I want to go back and get it. And it comes down to a choice, because now it becomes, well, what do I do now? The Bible tells you what to do. If you've left something, if you've left someone you love, if you've left God for something else, the Bible says, number one, repent. And we'll get into that in just a second. But the second thing that it tells us to do is go back to the things that you did in the beginning. Go back to the first works. Go back to the first deeds. What were you doing in the beginning when you were dating or were engaged, or that honeymoon period of your marriage? Go back to those things. Because when there's a gap, it's those things that can help close the distance in your life. For example, when's the last time that you sent your wife flowers that wasn't on Valentine's Day or their birthday? When's the last time you texted her simply, I love you, just to say I love you, not attached to anything else? When's the last time, because I know that I did this when we were dating, I would leave cards, write letters and leave cards on her windshield put them under the windshield wiper. I would go and visit her at work, not, you know, hopefully not getting her in trouble or anything like that.
He would drive all the way to the South Trust in Vestavia, and there was one right down the road from where you worked.
Just to say hello.
Just to drive through the drive-thru and see my face.
And see her face. When's the last time you did that, pursued that? When was the last time that you fought to stay on the phone with your spouse as opposed to fighting to get off? This is something that I do with her. I fight to stay on the phone with her. But she has me believe that she is so busy. David, I can't talk right now. I have to get off the phone. I have to get off the phone. I'm trying to fight to stay on the phone. And she's trying to get off.
And if you can't get me, if you can't keep me on the phone, you track me on the phone.
Exactly. Exactly. So are you doing things that you continue to pursue? Because what the Bible teaches us is this, is that intimacy is better than proximity.
Yeah.
And intensity is better than proximity.
Yeah.
You see this found over in Proverbs where the Bible talks about it's better to live in the housetop of a house with a peaceful wife than it is to live in a huge house watching the Super Bowl with a nagging wife.
Mm-hmm.
We have to fight to continually close the gap.
Yeah, you know, I came across a quote not long ago, and it said, many people marry their soulmate only to end up as roommates. And that's that proximity factor that you're talking about there. And it's really, really sad. And that's not the way God intended marriage. He intended us for live life to the fullest together in unity. And gaps are a real thing in marriage. I mean, I see it all of the time. And here's the other thing about gaps is that your kids are watching. Your kids are sensing when there's a gap. They know when there's distance between the mom and the dad. They feel it, and it affects them. They may never say it, but it affects them, and it affects them for years to come. I know when you and I were going through that season of living apart, what not by choice, just the circumstances that we found ourselves in, we definitely had a gap in proximity. But we did not have a gap in the intensity of our love for one another and intimacy, but we fought for it. I know we could talk on the phone every day for a few minutes. We could send emails back and forth, but that wasn't enough. David sent me letter after letter after letter pursuing me, just like what you're talking about, going back to the first thing that you did. He pursued me with everything he's got in me, professing his love for me, telling me how much he loved me, adored me, how beautiful that he thought I was. I found a notebook the other day. Just this stuff just kind of brings back a lot, you know, going through these times. And I found a notebook of all the letters that I kept of him when he was gone for 4.5 years. And it was just letter after letter thanking me for the kind of wife I am and the mother I am and everything else. And I'm telling you, he closed every gap. And it's not just gaps like that that we're talking about. You know, the enemy is the master. He is the father of bringing division in. And that's another word for gap is division. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 talks about, let there be no division among you. I know that's written to the church, but how much more in a marriage? And it says, let there be, that's an understood you. You, let there be no division among you. That's the responsibility of a husband and a wife, putting a stop to that and closing those gaps. Like I said, the gaps, they affect the children as well. And I know I talked about the letters you sent. One time he sent a flower in the mail to me. I love flowers. I love plants, but I don't like artificial ones. That's just not my thing. Some people do, and that's great. But he sent me an artificial rose in the mail. It was like a fake leather red rose, and it meant so much to me because it's all he could do. There was one day he sent me a gift wrapped in a piece of paper, and it was a four-leaf clover that he had found. It's not about the exotic things. That four-leaf clover, he wrapped it up in a piece of paper, and he used, you know, when you get a sheet of stamps, the border that the tape, the border on the sheet that, you know, after you peel the stamp off, he used the border tape to tape it like it was Scotch tape. He did everything in his power to make sure that I knew how much he loved me and honored me, and I felt it. And I'm telling you, he did whatever it took, and it took. And every gap was closed, and I praise God for it. But here's the other part of that. He pursued me very, very diligently. But our kids, I got to tell you about one time what happened with one of our kids. I was riding to the orthodontist with Trent. We were still living in California at the time. And he was just asking me some questions, nothing deep, just about my upbringing and how I was raised. And so I was telling him some things, you know, about how my life was different than his life. And I told him about how we, you know, it was normal for us to be stuck on the side of the road with a broken down car. That was just life for me. I told him about some of the responsibilities that I had as a child that he has no understanding of, you know, that why would a child have to do this or pay this? And we just struggled financially, and I was just telling him some of those things. And he listened to that, and he said, "Wow, Mom, I feel like I'm just so thankful for the way that you and Dad raised me, but I feel like I've never been through anything hard as a kid." Well, when he said that, because I knew what he had been through as a kid, I didn't react. I held my composure. But when we put the car in park and I was away from him, I just broke down, just thanking God. Because yes, it was the keeping power of God. And yes, it was the grace of God on us. But it was also a mom and a dad who closed the gaps, who said no to division, and who stayed unified. And those kids felt it. And they're still feeling it. And they never felt the hurt. So I praise God for that. Closing the gaps, they can start small, but shut it down when they start. It's worth it.
Amen. I hope you see the power behind that, because the only way that I was able to truly, truly and completely close the gap that was between her and I was going back to Revelation chapter 2, and that was closing the gap between me and God. And that means going back, yes, repent. And but going back to the very first things that when you get born again, when you are saved, think about your zeal and the love that you have for God. I mean, you're wanting to get into the Word. You're wanting to be a people around the Word. You're wanting to be in church. You're wanting to go more and more in depth. But the reason that I was able to pursue and close that gap, make sure that there was no division, is because I had also knew that there was a gap between God and I had to pursue it. And I had to close that distance as well. And so I hope that and pray that you see that any relationship, yeah, there's some things that you can do in the natural to narrow that gap. But if it's truly built around the Word of God, make sure that there's no distance between you and God. Make sure that that's tight. And as you do, you'll see that every other relationship issues from that. Mm-hmm. Point number two, or ingredient number two, is this. Pray for and with your spouse. Now, many of you are very familiar with the parable found over in Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. It's the parable of the two houses that were built. There were two guys that built two houses. And on the surface, and outwardly, externally, I'm sure they looked the same. They were Instagram worthy. They were on the face of Southern Living. I mean, Architectural Digest had featured them. I'm sure that they were filled with pleasant and precious riches from At Home, Our House, Pottery Barn. Everything probably on the outside looked identical. When people walked across them or saw them, they thought, "Man, that is a beautiful house. That is a beautiful house." And it's the same with marriage. People walk by and look at these marriages that are on Instagram, mm-hmm. Facebook, whatever it may be on the news, and they think, "Man, what a beautiful marriage." But then all of a sudden you hear about some devastation or catastrophe later on down the road. It goes back to what were those houses built upon? Because one man built on sand, and that is no foundation to build a house upon. The other man, he built on rock, and that is a sure foundation in our lives. And while both of them were built, the Bible actually alludes to that they were both great for a while. They both stood. And on the outwardly, they both looked amazing. Like, man, they've really got it going. But then a storm came. And as a result of that storm, one stood and one fell away. And that is exactly what you see with people when they separate or going through a divorce. You see where things either are standing or whether they are falling and crumbling, and it all goes back to the foundation. You know, Jesus' best for your marriage is that you are able to withstand any storm that comes your way. Mm-hmm. I'd love to be able to sit here and tell you that God's best for you is that you never encounter a storm, but that's not the case. We live in a curse-filled world, And there are hardships, difficulties, challenges, storms that are coming your way, not only in your marriage, but every other area of your life. God's best is that you've built on such a strong foundation that you are able to withstand and still be standing through that storm. It goes back to victory in your life is not when the devil leaves you alone. The Bible talks about even Satan, he tempted Jesus and left him for a season, but we know that he came back and harassed him, came against him. Victory in your life is not when Satan leaves you alone. Victory in your life is when you are untroubled and able to stand in the midst of any circumstance that you and your wife may face. Some of the storms, you know, Tara and I, we've dealt with all kinds of storms. Some of the storms we've seen coming, and most of them I've induced myself. It all goes back to the rock that you're built upon. And it's as simple as this. Jesus is the rock. And the best way to make Jesus the rock of your life, the rock of your relationships, the rock of your marriage, is to pray. And this morning, within this point, I want to give you two reasons why you should pray for your spouse. Number one, because you get a heart for who you pray for.
Yeah.
You get a heart for who you pray for.
Yeah.
Over in Matthew chapter 5, there's a scripture that says, this is Jesus talking, the Sermon on the Mount. He's in the middle, kind of getting ready to wrap some things up, but he says this. He says, I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. In other words, pray for your enemies. What are we praying for? Why would Jesus even tell this? Is he wanting us to pray for their demise? No, that doesn't mean that we pray that they jump off a building or fall off a building or have a car wreck. What we're praying, the reason that we're praying is so that our heart is protected. That's why we're praying. That's why we pray for our enemies. That's why we pray for our spouse, because it protects our heart. And when you pray for, the Lord can take that prayer and he can move even in your enemy's life. But it's to protect your heart. And when you pray for your spouse, you are getting a heart for your spouse. Mm-hmm. That heart is being enlarged. It is being enriched mm-hmm. towards your spouse. Mm-hmm. Because it is hard to be mad at someone. It is hard to hate someone when you've spent time praying for them. Mm-hmm. And so that's a reason to pray for your spouse, because you get a heart, you get an enlargement, an enrichment yeah. towards the person that you are praying for.
Yeah.
The second thing is that you get a heart for those that you pray with. The first one is you get a heart for those who you pray for. The second is you get a heart for who you pray with. Once again, an enlarging and an enriching of the heart of the towards the person that you were praying with. Yes, there are times that I am praying by myself in my own time of devotion. I am praying for Tara. And then there are times that I am praying with Tara. Your prayers, and you may be sitting here thinking, well, David, I mean, you know, does this have to be some long, drawn-out prayer? No, it doesn't have to be a long, drawn-out prayer like you may see, you know, with the Apostle Paul. It doesn't have to be long. There may be days, I mean, there have been times where I've certainly prayed in depth where Tara and I's relationship or things that were going on in her life, things that were applicable to her.
Applicable.
Thank you very much. That were towards her. And yet, on a consistent and on a regular basis, this is what I find myself praying. Routinely, it's not long prayers that I'm praying for Tara. It's simply this. Lord, thank you for my wife, Tara. I thank you that we are joined as one. We stick together. We cannot be torn asunder. Mm-hmm. That is straight the word of God. Mm-hmm. It's found over in Job. We are joined one together. Mm-hmm. We stick together, and we cannot be torn asunder. So what I encourage you to do when you're praying with someone, praying for someone, it's all right that you keep it short. Just be consistent in that moment.
Yeah, you know, praying for your spouse, it really does. It gives you a heart for them, no matter where you're at in your relationship, if you're in, you know, a wonderful season or if you're in a difficult season. But here's the other thing that praying for your spouse does. A lot of times we see something going on that we're on the outside, we think they need to fix this, or this needs to be altered, or this needs to be changed, or whatever. And we think we take that upon ourselves of how can they do this? How can they fix that? But when you just pray for them, you're releasing the care of them. And that's absolutely right. You're casting the care of them into the hands of the one who can change them. I saw a quote, and I love it, and I've taken it as my own, but by Lisa Turkhurst. She said, God does not want me to be a fix-him wife. God wants me to be a love-him wife. And you know, the same thing is true for husbands. God does not want you to be a fix-her husband. God wants you to be a love-her husband. And one of the greatest ways that we can love each other is praying for each other. That's working your heart with God's heart to their heart. There's no greater team that can change somebody than that, or that can help somebody than that. And I found this verse months ago, and I keep going back to it, and I thought it really applied to this. It's in Psalm 46, verse 10 in the Passion Translation. It says, surrender your anxiety, be silent, and stop your striving, and you will see that I am God. Surrender your anxiety. Anytime any kind of anxious thought comes to me, whether it's about a relationship, whether it's about finances, whether it's about one of our kids, whether it's about him, anything, I just, first thing, surrender the anxiety. Yeah. I give it to God. And then it says, be silent, stop your striving, and you will see that I am God. We all want to see God. I want to see God in my marriage, always. I want to see God in my children's lives. I want to see God in my life, the effect of him, his hand at work in our lives. But I'm not going to get a God kind of marriage, a God kind of life, without doing what the first things are. And that is to surrender my anxiety, to be silent, stop using those negative words like I talked about last week, and stop striving with the word of God. Stop talking against this and work with it. You know, it goes back to Miss Peggy's confession. I talked about it last week. But I'm telling you, there's such life in that story, such life in that testimony. And she has shared it with so many people who have come to her in tears. Miss Peggy, what do I do about my kids? Miss Peggy, what do I do about my husband? And am I right? So many people. And she'll give it to them, but they're not doing it. But it's really simple. It's a confession. And this is what she did. I called her a couple of years ago, and I said, I want to get that confession verbatim so I can speak it over my kids. But this is what she told me on that day. She said, this is what the Lord told me to say. Thank you, Lord, for the man that Scott Webb is in you. Thank you for the tender heart of love that flows out to his family and all those around him. Then tongues, tongues, tongues. Praying in the Spirit. That's what she said. Tongues, tongues, tongues. Here's what I believe happened. I believe the confession that God gave her, it turned his life around. He gave her the instruction, she obeyed, and she got the results. But then the tongues, 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 that's a big part in everything you see today. That's a big part in all of those nations that his boots have been in. That's a big part in the word that's gone around the world because of the gift in him. That's the benefit, and that is the beauty of praying in the Spirit over our spouses and over our families, is that it takes us where our mind can't conceive, and it does the work. So pray in the Spirit over your families and over your husbands, over your wife if you're a man. And I will say this, men, listen to me. There is nothing more attractive, more respectable, more valuable to a woman than a man who leads spiritually. Nothing. A man who will pray for his family, a man who will take the time and pray with his family, is invaluable. You cannot put a price on that. I know in this season of life, you know, we don't have kids at home anymore. I didn't know if we'd like it this much, but we like it.
Yes, we do.
But anytime we're together now, because it's few and far between, David gathers our family around, and he prays over our boys. especially Clay, when we're with Clay, he takes the time and he goes over there and he lays his hands on him, speaks the word over him, and blesses him. And as a praying mom, there is nothing more precious to me, comforting, strengthening to me, than seeing a man who will do those kinds of things. So don't ever hesitate to pray over your family and to be bold about it. And yeah, I'm seeing the hand of God at work because of the praying, but here's the other thing, is it's sending a message to our kids. Our kids are seeing it, and we're sending what started with this generation, we're sending it through the rest of the generations in this bloodline. Amen. Amen.
You know, there is a place for prayer in your marriage. You need to find and make a place of prayer with your spouse. There is a place and a place to pray in the spirit with your spouse and for your spouse. You know, a lot of times I think the Holy Ghost, you know, we just look at it as, well, as we're praying in the Holy Spirit, that, well, the Lord, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to tell me to do something. And, you know, that's the reason I pray in the Holy Spirit, because when he tells me to do something, then I'll do something. When the Holy Spirit tells you to do something, when he's talking to you, there's more behind it than him just telling you to do something for the sake of doing something. Behind it is life.
Yeah.
Behind it is power. Mm-hmm. Behind it is love. That when it's released into that relationship, when it's released into your marriage, you've been praying in the spirit for your spouse, and yes, he tells you to do something. If you'll do this, if you'll do this act of love, if you'll tell her this, if you'll do this for her, it will, you know, yes, it will close the distance, but even beyond that, the power, the energy, the love that is behind it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's amazing what praying in the spirit with and for your spouse can do.
Mm-hmm.
So I encourage you. That's ingredient or point number two. And then finally for today, we'll have to pick up here next week. But number three is squash selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the ouch moment of today's message. I know many of you may feel like you stubbed your toe, but selfishness is a spiritual disease.
Yeah.
It is a virus that does its works first and foremost on the inside of the individual before it ever exudes or is seen externally.
Mm-hmm.
And the two ways that you squash selfishness is this. You need to take this approach and attitude. Be the first to repent and be the first to forgive. If you want to squash selfishness in your life, yes, that moment may come to you. You may even stick your toe or put a foot into it. Have the opportunity when it flares up. But if you want to draw back from that, get beyond that, you either look for the opportunity to be the first to repent or be the first to forgive.
Mm-hmm.
Because when selfishness flares up, something comes up between two individuals who by all accounts should be close to one another. But what happens? They often go in different directions. They give each other the silent treatment. And there is nobody in this room who is watching via live stream that was more the king of the silent treatment than I was. I was an expert at it. When something would come up, when something didn't go my way, giving her the silent treatment. Being selfish in that moment. Something I've had to learn to work through. Something I've had to become mature about. And look for the ways. And I'm telling you, the way to beat those moments back is be the first to repent and to be the first to forgive when those moments flare up.
Yeah.
You know, the default response in a marriage is when selfishness or a moment rises up of jealousy or envy or just an argument or an offense is, well, I'm going to let you make it right first. I'm going to let you go first. I'm going to let you repent first. I'm going to let you come back to me and initiate the conversation first. That is not what Jesus taught. Matthew chapter 7, verse 5 says this, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then thou shalt see clearly to cast out the mote of thy brother's eye. Instead of trying to fix the other person, fix yourself first.
Mm-hmm.
Before you begin that journey back to that other person, yes, you repent. And what does repent mean? It means to turn and head in the opposite direction. So there's this moment of friction. There's this argument. There's this fight. There's this moment of selfishness. Something has cropped up. What do? you turn around and you pursue that person. You head in the other direction. You head back towards them. But don't head back towards them with the attitude of, well, I'm going to fix you. Make sure that you fixed yourself first. Yeah. Make sure that you've dealt with yourself first. I mean, when this moment pops up and the selfishness pops up, I mean, great. Okay, you proved your point. But now no one likes you. Mm-hmm. What do you do? What do you do? You've got to understand that those moments are not birthed out or birthed by God. Mm-hmm. They're birthed by the devil. Mm-hmm. They're birthed by the curse. They're birthed by just the flesh. How do you overcome those things? You see it in Matthew chapter 4. Satan has taken Jesus up on the mount of temptation. Jesus finds himself there up there, and Satan comes to him and he says, again, the devil takes him up into an exceeding high mountain and shows him all the kingdom of the world and the glory of them, and says unto them, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then said Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. In other words, the devil's saying, if you give me what I want, I'll give you what you want. Hmm. That's what selfishness does. Yeah. You give me what I want, you say to me what I want, then I'll give you what you want. You want dinner, then you do this for me. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'll change when you change. Mm. And selfishness doesn't approach it that way. What do we do? Instead of waiting for our wife or our spouse to lay down their will and come back to us, what we need to do is lay down our will, mm-hmm, and go back to them, whether it's to forgive them or whether it's to repent and make things right.
Sometimes I think, what really could happen in a marriage if the husband and a wife did everything in their power to rid themselves of selfishness? Everything. To just get it out of their life. It'd be heaven on earth. It'd be heaven on earth. You know, we talk a lot about the passage in 2 Timothy chapter 3 about the last days, it being perilous times. And it's true. And we see it all around us. You know, there's perilous times. But if you go down in that passage, the characteristics and the description of the last times are inward things. It's heart stuff. It's people stuff. And the very first one listed is, men shall be lovers of their own selves. Selfishness. You see it everywhere. It is so prevalent in our society and in our world. But we must not allow it in our home. Selfishness must be gotten rid of. And we do, like David was saying, you do this, I'll do this. You know, and we do. We reason and we form reasonings within ourselves, arguments within ourselves of why we're right about this and why I'm standing my ground and he's going to have to do this and this is going to have to happen and all of that. It's all birthed out of selfishness. You take, for instance, the mindset of, well, I'm the primary breadwinner here. I make all the money here. And so you need to do this and this and this and this. That's selfishness. It's selfish. A marriage is a team. It's a covenant. It's a united covenant. And it's not something that selfishness can be a part of if you want the blessing. Let me ask you this. Who gave you the power to get that wealth in the first place? It's the same one who told you to love one another. It's the same one who told you to prefer each other. It's the same one who told you to honor one another. And without his blessing on your life, you could lose it all. So rid yourself of selfishness. It's worth it. I look at a couple like Hugh and Quinetta. When I was thinking about this, I thought about Hugh and Quinetta. Hugh Edwards is a hardworking man, and he is a good man. He's a man after God's own heart. The blessing of God is all over him. Quinetta doesn't work a full-time job. She doesn't earn a paycheck like he does. But every time I see her strutting a new outfit.
That's right.
She comes in here styling and profiling every time the doors are open. And that's why the blessing is on Hugh Edwards. Yeah. Because he's generous and there's not a selfish bone in his body. He lives to serve and to honor his wife. And she does the same thing. That's beautiful. Yeah. That's godly. That's honorable, and that's something that one day we're all going to stand before Jesus and give account for, how we treated our spouse, how we treated our family. Now, this sounds silly. It may be silly to you, and it's simple. But I'll tell you something that happened in mine and David's relationship and in our marriage several years ago. And it, you may think, what? But just bear with me a minute. So we have our favorite time of the day just about is afternoon coffee time. We have it 2 o'clock. We have afternoon coffee just about every day. And so one day we had poured, or he had poured the coffee. I made it. He poured it. And he poured the first cup, and he pushed the cup over to me. He said, here, you get the tithe. And I said, what? He said, you get the tithe. You get the first. You get the best. And I just kind of laughed it off, you know. Next day, he did the same thing. Here, you get the tithe. He kept laughing at it. Well, then I would do it. I say, no, you get the tithe. No, you get the tithe. No, you get the tithe. And we go back and forth like that. And just a game. Now we do it at mealtime. We're always trying to make the other one take the first. But you know what it did? It developed into an attitude. It developed into our mode of operation in our house. There is no selfishness in our marriage. There is none. We always prefer the other one over the other, I think.
I believe so.
Yeah.
Yep.
But it started years ago, but that is one simple act. And I tell you the other thing, we didn't put our heads together and say, hey, how can we develop this attitude in our house? How can we squash selfishness in our marriage? How can we fix this? We didn't put our heads together and do it. It took one person, one party, making that simple gesture, and it created an attitude and an atmosphere in our house. And it's fun, and it's joyful, and it's lovely. So selfishness is a killer.
Yes, it is.
In a marriage.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to pick up here next week, and I just want to remind you of those three things that we gave you this morning. Fight to close the gap. Continually close the gap in your marriage and your relationships, even with God. And then pray for and with your spouse. And then squash selfishness. Because remember, we've said this, you know, pretty much all throughout this series, is that marriage is not 50-50. It's not 50% me, 50% her, and then all of a sudden we have this 100% complete and fulfilled marriage. No, marriage is 100% you.
Yeah.
It's 100% me. It's me giving 100% to our marriage, you giving 100% to our marriage. And as you do those things, that's where that unity and the knitting of heart comes in.
Yeah.
Because you need to understand, you have a covenant that is stronger than your storms. You have a covenant with God that is stronger than any storm.
Yeah.
You have a covenant that when built upon the rock where your marriage is concerned is stronger than any storm that can come against you. So we're going to